This morning's scripture is from Exodus 16, 1 through 12. The whole congregation of the Israelites set out from Elim. And Israel came to the wilderness of Sin, which is between Elim and Sinai. On the 15th day of the second month after they had departed from the land of Egypt, the whole congregation of the Israelites complained against Moses and Aaron in the wilderness. The Israelites said to them, "If only we had died by the hand of the Lord in the land of Egypt, when we sat by the flesh pots and ate our fill of bread. For you have brought us out into this wilderness to kill this whole assembly with hunger." Then the Lord said to Moses, "I am going to rain bread from heaven for you. And each day the people shall go out and gather enough for that day. In that way I will test them, wherever they will follow my instructions or not. On the sixth day, when they prepare what they bring in, it will be twice as much as they gather on the other days." So Moses and Aaron said to all the Israelites, "In the evening you shall know that it was the Lord who brought you out of the land of Egypt. And in the morning you shall see the glory of the Lord, because he has heard your complaining against the Lord. For what are we that you complain against us?" And Moses said, "When the Lord gives you meat to eat in the evening and your fill of bread in the morning, because the Lord has heard the complaining that you utter against him, what are we? Your complaining is not against us, but against the Lord." Then Moses said to Aaron, "Say to the whole congregation of the Israelites, 'Draw near to the Lord, for he has heard your complaining.'" And as Aaron spoke to the whole congregation of the Israelites, they looked towards the wilderness, and the glory of the Lord appeared in the cloud. The Lord spoke to Moses and said, "I have heard the complaining of the Israelites. Say to them, 'At twilight you shall eat meat, and in the morning you shall have your fill of bread. Then you shall know that I am the Lord your God.'" The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
October was a crazy month for me. I went on a mission trip, completed my annual 57-mile bike ride for MS, went home for my grandma's funeral. My mom came to visit, and to close out the month, I did a wedding in Chattanooga. Last weekend when I returned home from the wedding, I discovered that season 2 of Stranger Things had come out on Netflix, and a number of my friends had already binge-watched the entire season. At which point I realized my friends must either not have jobs or work way fewer hours. I have since had time to start season 2, but I have been limiting myself to an episode a night at the most, except for on Halloween when I binge-watch 2 episodes. If you are a fan of the show Stranger Things, you know why it is so addicting. If you haven't seen the show, it is essentially about a group of 12-year-old boys growing up in Indiana in the 1980s, where strange things start to happen. I read an article that said that one of the reasons the show is so popular is because of the sense of nostalgia it gives to those who grew up in and lived through the 1980s. The show literally starts 10 days before I was born, so I can't say that I share the same sense of nostalgia as those who actually remember that decade. But I do have a sense of nostalgia for some of the 80s movies from which Stranger Things gets its inspiration, including E.T., which was the first VHS I owned, The Goonies, which I have seen countless times, and of course, Ghostbusters. I also identify with the freedom with which the boys are able to explore their world on their bikes in rural Indiana in the 1980s. It is a freedom that most kids these days do not have, especially if they live in a large city like Nashville. That makes me a little sad and makes me long for the good old days. Nostalgia creates in us a longing to return to a happier time and place. It reminds us of the good things that happened in the past, while at the same time allowing us to forget the things that were not so good. For example, we may remember the 1980s as a time when kids played freely without fear. They spent entire days outside without bike helmets or adult supervision. But we may forget that there was no way to get in touch with them if they didn't come home for dinner, because there were no cell phones. We may also forget that the AIDS epidemic reached its peak in the 80s and 90s and was even more deadly than the current opioid crisis. Not to mention all the progress that has been made in medicine, not just for the treatment of AIDS, but for so many different diseases. So we could also look back on the 80s and be reminded of all the bad things that could have happened. But unless you experience some sort of trauma during that time, you are probably more likely to look back with nostalgia, remembering the good times and forgetting the bad. As Christians, remembering is an important part of our faith. We remember the life of Jesus when he walked on earth in human form, and we remember the works that God has done for us throughout history. In communion, we remember the sacrifice that Jesus made for us on the cross. And in baptism, we remember that we have been claimed by God. We also remember, especially today, the lives of the saints who have gone before us, carrying on the Christian faith and its traditions. But our remembering as Christians is markedly different from nostalgia. Whereas nostalgia makes us long to return to a former time and place, our faith calls us to remember what God has done in the past so that we can live full of expectation and hope for what God will do in the future. God does not call us to return to the past, but rather to follow Jesus in the present, wherever we are in life. In Exodus 23, the Israelites are not living with hope and expectation. Instead, they have become nostalgic. There's really no other way to describe their longing to return to Egypt. Somehow they have forgotten their enslavement at the hand of Pharaoh. They have forgotten all of the times that Pharaoh said that he would let the Egyptians go free, but then refused to do so. They have forgotten that the Pharaoh ordered all of their newborn males to be killed. Despite all that happened in Egypt, they are ready to turn around and head back into slavery, simply because they have experienced hardship out in the desert. Of course, this type of nostalgia is not limited to the Israelites in biblical times. It is not uncommon to hear Christians today say things like, "Remember when we had this many members in our church?" Or, "Remember when so-and-so was pastor here?" Or, "Remember when we were allowed to pray in the schools?" And while there's nothing wrong with remembering good times from the past, it is important that we don't become so stuck in the past that we fail to recognize what God is actively doing today in our world. While times change both for the better and for the worse, God remains constant and continues to work in and through us in the world today. Each of us have the choice to continue walking towards the promised land or to return to the slavery and bondage we had without Christ. If I'm honest, I have a certain sense of nostalgia for the times when I was a student and had a lighter workload and could have stayed up all night and binged on a series like Stranger Things. But at the same time, if that were true, I would not be here at Glendale to be a part of the exciting things that God is doing in this church today. Today we celebrate All Saints, where we remember and celebrate the lives of the saints that have gone before us. This includes those we have known personally, but also the saints that have gone before us throughout history. This includes the Israelites, who despite their nostalgia for the past, eventually continued on to the promised land. It includes the apostles and all of those who remained firm in their faith despite fierce persecution, sometimes even giving up their life for what they believed in. It includes people like Martin Luther and John Wesley. And it includes all of those who have been a part of creating Glendale and all of those who have influenced each of us today. And while we will, of course, remember the things that they did in the past, we also move forward knowing that the things that they taught us and the work that they did paved the way for us to be here in this place and in this moment, just as we are preparing the way for those who will come after us. And through it all, we have a God that connects us past, present, and future. To those who do not know our Lord, it may seem a strange thing that we can remain hopeful, even as we remember the past. But to those of us who know our Creator, we have been given the hope that comes from being a part of God's eternal kingdom that was and is to come. Let us pray. God of the ages, we thank you for everything that you have done in the past and for what you are still doing in the present and will continue to do in the future. Although it may seem strange to those who do not know you, we praise you for the ways that you can make all things new. As we remember those who have gone before us today, Lord, fill us with the hope of what you still have in store for each of us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.